My name is Leanne Chen. I'm the executive director at Khmer Girls in Action. And I have the honor to introduce our very first performances for tonight. So we're going to have two performances at the beginning and at the very end. So I hope folks could stay to the very end to watch the closeout of the performance. So I want to introduce folks to an artist who's going to come up here shortly. She is someone who I think everybody knows really well. So her name is June. She's a community artist. She's really well known here in Long Beach. And every time she come up onto the stage, she rocked the house. So June, can you come on up, please?
Not black, not white, other. As in any meaning to your existence is black, white, or other. As if our worldview only exists in black and white, but not other. And so we do what we can to be seen, mimicking what it means to be either black or white, whether it's on TV or in our streets, to not just be an other. Because when you ask me where I'm from, I'll tell you, I'm from here. I know no other. Ghetto, whitewashed, hip hop, rock and roll, Hillary, Trump, right, wrong, but no other. As if there is only a good or a bad, but not other. There are two acts scripted for us to recite. The first is a sitcom entitled Act One, An American Dream, The Good Citizen, sponsored by corporate interests like Apple and Coca-Cola, who will feed you the character life you're supposed to lead. Go to school, get good grades, go to college, find an internship, stay out of trouble and get a job at any one of these companies with your degree so you can one day work for me and repeat for your future generation to see. Currently casting young white males, preferably trust fund babies or those who can portray them. But what happens when you are other? Slip through the cracks because no one had your back, went to school but didn't pass because your brain was wondering how long you'd last. U.S. history never wrote in your family, making you feel you don't even belong in this all-American cast. Act Two, a production based on reality entitled An American Failure, The Bad Citizen, brought to you by Corporate Corrections of America, casting calls for young people of color, black and Latino men preferred. Goes to school, lazy, slacks off, gets kicked out or drops out, busts a crime, goes to prison, and ends up working for the same companies as the good citizen. But this is punishment. You are a slave, now called inmate, shackled into the new Jim Crow with no pension or good pay. And you're still not black, not white, not Latino, not even American, but called other. Serve the time for your crime, but they don't even ask where you're from anymore. Now they'll tell you, go back to where you came from. But this is my home. I know no other. Where is my home? Go back to where you came from. Where is my home? I know no other. Go back to where you come from. What is my home? Give me an other. Another chance, another way to show I am more than just an other. I am the Cambodian son who dropped out of my high school to help pay my family's bills. I am the Vietnamese daughter who translated meetings with a counselor for my parents when I wished they could be the ones to translate for me. I am the Samoan mother who protected her child from her husband's fists. I am the Tongan father whose cheapest medicine for depression was alcohol. I am the Hmong brother who was told not to cry, to toughen up, to be a man and to prove it. I am the Laotian sister whose uncle did not know boundaries over her body, so learned to defend myself. I and the Pakistani child whose gender identity was punishable by death in my home country so found comfort in your Hollywood streets. I am the Bangladeshi immigrant who sought asylum as a result of your drones dropped in my homeland. I am the Chinese American fed up with being called a chink, the Filipina caretaker who quietly nursed your elderly citizens below minimum wage for over 20 years, the Korean worker sewing 16-hour days in a downtown LA garment factory and still couldn't afford childcare, and that is my child you locked away. I am sorry, and I am not. I am more than just my crime. I am more than just jail time for my mistakes. I am a human whose story has never been heard, and I am more than just my ethnicity or where I come from. You love my culture, eat our foods, explore our ancestors' land with a passport and stamp, as if to you borders and oceans don't exist when they were created to separate me from all that I have loved and known. You have yet to get to know my people, taking only parts of us that you like to claim as your own, and I will no longer tolerate, for I am restoration, rehabilitation, and I am transformation. While you may see me as other, I am a product of this nation. As a matter of fact, I helped to build it. If our schools are not educating, it is time for us to be their teachers, to rewrite and flip the script that erased us out. You do not own the copyright to my story. I am the author, and this is just the beginning. I will choose an other solution, another choice, a narrative with no incarceration, no profit over my body, no deportation to a place your military has already tainted, no silence over my words. I am loud. I am fierce. I am neither a good or bad American citizen, and for this ending, this is not an act. I will write an other.
Thank you, June. And now I would like to bring up Ben Wang. Ben is the producer and director of the film we're about to watch, but Ben is gonna actually introduce something real quick.
So I just want to welcome everybody. This is the first ever screening of Breathin' in Long Beach. So we're really excited to have this premiere with all of you. And thanks so much to KGA and the California Endowment for hosting us and making this possible. You know, we've been able to, you know, we've been fortunate enough to screen this film at various film festivals, but it's always, I think, great to have these community screenings for Eddy and I especially. And through the Asian Prisoner Support Committee, Eddy and I have also, you know, had the fortune to work with KGA and CCE, so this does feel like a special screening to us. So thank you very much for having us.
At the age of 16, I committed a crime of home invasion robbery. I was the youngest prisoner in San Quentin's maximum security prison. I ended up spending 19 years inside the prison system. I was in the hole for 11 months for signing a proposal for ethnic studies and Asian American studies.
The only human contact would be when the guards put their handcuffs on us.
How do you be in the prison system and be free mentally? The victory for you have is get that mental freedom, and then it's gonna lead you to physical freedom for life.
There are always gonna be struggles. The day that there's no more struggle is the day that I'm not breathing. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I'm super excited right now because we have very awesome panel speakers with us tonight. And do folks all recognize Eddy? Yeah. And then Ben, he was also in the clip. So I'm gonna just do a very quick introduction and then we'll get started with some of the questions for our panelists. Tonight, we will be exploring how the school-to-prison-to-deportation pipeline impacts the Asian American and Pacific Islander populations, particularly here in Long Beach. This city is home to the largest Cambodian population outside of Cambodia, and we have a sizable population of Tongans and Samoans. Due to the model minority myth and the lack of real data, AAPI narratives are often silenced or invisible. In this panel, we get to highlight additional stories as well as our role in the larger movement to prioritize preventions, interventions, restorative and transformative approaches to advance justice, uplift our people, and ultimately to work towards ending this mass incarceration system here in the US. Right next to me is Stephanie Sim. Stephanie is a senior at Polytechnic High School. She is a youth organizer at Khmer Girls in Action. And she has been involved in the last 4 years. Her parents are refugees from Cambodia, and she is the youngest of 9 kids. Next to Stephanie is Eddy. And next to Eddy, since everybody already know about Eddy, next to Eddy, we have our brother, Clement Mac Brown. His family is from Samoa, and Clement is going to be sharing his story with us tonight. And then folks already got a quick intro to Ben earlier tonight. He is. We have a lot of excited youth in the audience tonight. And then last but not least, we have Jacqueline Dan. She is the staff attorney at Asian American Advancing Justice. And she is a practicing lawyer and have been dealing with a lot of issue around challenging unlawful immigration detention and deportation. So she will also be sharing some of her insight with us tonight. So Clement, I would like to start off by asking you to share your story of incarceration with us. And so what happened to you and what helped you get out?
In 1978, my parents brought us from Samoa to Orange County for a better life. You know, at the time I was 16. I got here. I had a strong accent. You know, trying to fit in. Immediately surrounded myself with individuals that I shouldn't have. You know, I was naive, but not stupid. You know, so I'm not going to sit here and make excuses. But I wasn't hanging around kids who were going to Bible study every Tuesdays and Thursdays. You know, I was hanging around with individuals who were hanging out in garages, skipping class. And one thing led to another. I started using drugs, mainly cocaine, and then ended up committing a murder, a drug robbery murder. And October 1985, I got sentenced to 26 years to life for first-degree murder. I entered the prison system and immediately embraced the prison politics that were there. You know, I continued to hang around individuals I wasn't supposed to be hanging around in there. Was grateful for the family support that I had, but continued to go in and out of the hole till my last trip to the hole in San Quentin, October 26, 2006. My dad ended up passing away while I was in the hole. So when I got out of the hole, my baby brother came up there to visit me with my mom and my sister, and he told me, he says, "Yeah, I can't see you going in and out of the hole after 20-something years. You know, dad, he wanted to retire and go back to Samoa, and he could have lived like a king with his retirement. You know, but he didn't want to leave you here like this. You know, so he stayed here and died here waiting for you. You know, so if you're not going to change for yourself, at least change for dad." You know, so for some reason that day, I ended back to the unit, and there was this list that the Walden House Substance Abuse Program had put up there, a list that I used to, because I was at the head of the food chain at this prison, I used to convince and encourage other Asians and Pacific Islanders not to sign up for it, you know, because there were certain guidelines that were on that yard that we disagreed with that didn't coincide with the prison politics, you know. So, but I ended up putting my name up there, you know, to the surprise of a lot of individuals on that yard. So I ended up on the SAP yard and did like the least amount of time on that yard with the changes that I had made, you know. And on June 30th, 2013, I got released from prison, you know, after doing over 28 years, you know. So, I'm nervous. You know, I never did an interview like this, but hey, man, it is awesome to be out here.
This is Clement's first panel, by the way, folks. Beck, thank you so much for sharing your story. I'm going to have a follow-up question for you in a moment. So I actually want to kind of bring in a young person's voice right now. So Stephanie, last year marked the 40th year since the Southeast Asian refugees were displaced by war, genocide, forced migration. Most families were resettled into very difficult conditions in impoverished neighborhoods where folks were vulnerable to poverty, crime, violence, structural disadvantages, racism, discrimination, and profiling. And I would like to invite you to share your personal story and your family's struggle with your brother's deportation.
All right, hello everyone. I'm Stephanie Sim. I'm a senior in high school again, and I'm a youth organizer at Khmer Girls in Action. And Khmer Girls in Action is a youth organization that fights for racial, gender, and economic justice. And again, today I'm here to share you guys about the story of my brother's deportation, how it impacted my family and I. So the last time I saw my brother was right before he got deported in 2010, and not a day goes by where my mother and I don't worry about him or think about him. So my family came to the U.S. as refugees. They came to escape the genocide and war that was occurring in Cambodia. They resettled here in 1989 along with five of their kids, and my mom was pregnant with her sixth. She now has 9 kids, and I'm the youngest. My brother, Sarab, the one who got deported, was born in Thailand's refugee camp, and he was only 3 when he arrived there. So when my family got here, none of them spoke English, and this put my parents in a position where they had to find the easiest yet the hardest job of being a seamstress, and we've been struggling financially ever since, and you don't make that much money being a seamstress. The U.S. is very different from Cambodia, and it was difficult for my parents and older siblings to assimilate into this new country. My parents didn't get to have the education or the opportunities that they have now, and my mother is very hardworking. She would push herself to, like, she would go overboard to provide for her kids. So now, my mother, she pushes us to have the opportunities that she never got to have. And unfortunately, my brother won't be able to have this opportunity because he's been forced back into the country that he originally escaped from. I don't really remember much of growing up with my brother, but I do know that he's a high school graduate. He loves car, and he did get in trouble a couple of times for nonviolent crimes, and he spent some time in jail for it. When he was released, he wanted to get his life together, so he continued looking for a job. He was on and off with, like, he was very stressed out trying to look for a job. He kept applying for it, he just kept looking for it, and it was very difficult on him because it's hard to find a job when you don't have a criminal when you do have a criminal record. Soon, he, like, managed to get a job. He enrolled into college. He met his beautiful girlfriend, and they eventually moved in together, and soon enough, they were expecting a son, and he was really excited about it. We finally thought everything was going to be okay for him, and we finally thought we were going to be at peace. And then one day, I was in middle school at the time, and I got a call from his girlfriend, and she was at the courthouse, and they were at one of his routine check-in. And she was crying, she was panicking, and she was telling me that my brother was going to jail and that he was going to get deported. I was really scared. I was confused. So I called my mom, and she came home immediately. She was really stressed. She was like trying to figure out what was going on and why was this happening, and everything was happening so unexpectedly. And then over the next couple of months, I was really confused about what was going on. And I just heard my mom call on the phone talking about the places my brother was getting transferred to and where he was going. And 6 years ago, right before the holidays, me and my family, we drove up to Seattle, and that was the last time we saw my brother. And that was the first time I really saw his one-month-old son. This has taken a huge toll on me, because it was difficult for me to focus in school and trying to maintain grades. And I don't know, it was just difficult overall because it hurt me to see my family, and my mother was in pain having to witness her son being taken away from her. My brother was only 3 when he arrived here, so he was not familiar with the country himself, and he had to start his life all over. And this has put a huge financial toll on us having to provide for him there while my mother had to provide for us here. And I felt that it was unfair for me to have to go through this while trying to maintain my grade and not only make myself happy, but my mom proud. And it's difficult to balance out school and to think about my brother. And sometimes I will be so stressed and so upset that I'm not thinking about him and putting me in a place where I'm feeling guilty, trying to like take care of myself first. And after all that my mother has been through, I wanted to be able to make her proud and to finally have her be at peace with herself. And no one should have to experience having a family member being taken away from them. And when I was involved with KGA, I've learned that there were laws in place that allows deportation to happen. And this creates a huge opening for deportation more likely to occur. And it's important to end all deportation, and bringing our deported home will allow our entire community to heal and finally live their life to the fullest and at peace.
Thank you for sharing, Stephanie. I actually have a very quick follow-up question for you, because you talk a lot about the impact of your brother's deportation on you as well as on your mother. And I wanted to see if you could comment a little bit around women's role in supporting and maintaining our family, because oftentimes that's overlooked, particularly in cases of incarceration and deportation. What services do you think women need? And what helped you, Stephanie?
So deportation breaks families apart, and usually it's like people think that it's only the person that's getting deported that it impacts, but that's not exactly true. It impacts the family also. And, you know, my whole family had to deal with the whole deportation, and including his own family and his son. And it created a lot of stress for everyone. We were all very worried. And it kind of put, well, it did. It put an emotional toll on us. And it, you know, it hurt to see my mom all stressed because she was very hurt. She was, I don't know, she was, it was draining on her. And the support that we needed the most was an emotional and mental support system. And I guess having like a support group or someone to come out and reach out to my mother about the way she was feeling, to talk about everything she was going through. Because I know, like, seeing my mom, she was embarrassed about what was happening. And she felt like she was alone, like she had no one to turn to because she never went through this before. And also it was, we needed help financially. Because it cost a lot of money for us to go out and to visit our brother and to support him financially out there. And it still happens today. We're in a very unstable position. And for me, it was being involved with KGA. They taught me how to cope with myself, with everything I was going through. They taught me, well, they actually, since I was confused about what was going on with the whole deportation stuff, KGA taught me what was happening with my brother, what was going on, what deportation was. And they taught me how to create my story and how I should use it to fight for my brother to come back. You know, it was like a way for me not to hold everything in, to like really talk about it. And, you know, KGA really supported me through it all.
So Stephanie, your story really remind me of the many hidden scar in our community and the historical trauma that's kind of on top of that. So Jacqueline, I want to bring you into this conversation because this year marks the 20th anniversary of the 1996 Illegal Immigration Reform and Immigrant Responsibility Act, also known as IRA-IRA, which resulted in the rise of mass deportation and have separated millions of families across the U.S. For the Cambodian diaspora in the United States, this has hit our community particularly hard. The school-to-prison-to-deportation pipeline is not only messed up, it's now retroactive, meaning those who have taken accountability for their wrongdoing and have served their time are receiving a lifetime sentence in the form of deportation back to a home country they have fled or have never stepped foot in. The impact in our communities are often neglected in this mass deportation machine. And our country has been complicit to the endangerment of deportees. And Jacqueline, in your role as an immigrant rights lawyer, you support a lot of folks on the prison to deportation pipeline. Can you share some of the challenges from your perspective and what are some potential solutions?
Okay, sure, and thank you for having me here. So one of the first things that I just wanted to make sure we all understand is, so many of us who are born in the United States, so if you're born on US soil, unless you're born in American Samoa, actually, you are a US citizen by birth. That means that no matter what you do in the United States, because of your citizenship, it protects you from ever being forcibly removed from this country. But for people who are born outside of the United States, if you come to the United States, you're not automatically granted citizenship. You actually have to apply for it. And you have to meet certain conditions before that happens. So there are a lot of people in the United States who, even if they came here lawfully as refugees, or their family brought them here, or an employer brought them here, you have to wait a certain number of years, and then you have to apply. You have to pay hundreds and hundreds of dollars. You have to take an exam. You have to take an oath of allegiance. And these are things that a lot of people either do not know that they need to do not have the money to do, or they just don't really have the knowledge or services available to them to help them do it. There are a lot of people in our community that never got their citizenship, even though for all intents and purposes, they seem like they're American, and they are, they feel like it. You see them as Americans, but the United States government doesn't see it that way. So basically what happens is if you commit a crime in the United States or you're convicted of one, the United States government sees that as kind of like you breaking a contract with them. And in their minds, they can go ahead and take steps against you if you haven't taken that last step of getting citizenship to remove you from this country because they no longer want you here. So in 1996, a pair of laws was passed. So the first one is IRA-IRA. The other is the, it's also very long, Anti-Terrorism and Effective Death Penalty Act, or AEDPA. So basically, these two laws passed by Congress in 1996 and signed into law by President Clinton at the time, did four things that you really need to know about. First, it expanded the number or the types of immigrants that can be put in immigration detention indefinitely while their case is before an immigration judge. What happens before you're an immigrant, when you're in front of an immigration judge, is the judge decides whether you are going to stay in the United States or you're going to be deported. Okay, so it's like a court hearing, kind of like a criminal court hearing. Only if you're subject to mandatory detention, that means you don't get bond. There's no bail for you. So 1996 laws actually set defined a class of immigrants that will be detained without bond, fighting their cases for what could be, it could be 2 weeks if you give up, it could be 6 months, but you know, 1 year, 2 years is not unheard of either. And during that entire time, you're in an immigration detention facility, which is basically a jail, very far from your family. The next thing that happened was it eliminated a lot of defenses that you could argue in front of the judge, saying basically, well, I've been in the United States for a very long time. I was not incarcerated beyond a certain amount of time. And here are the things that I've done to make amends. Here are the good things in my life. This is how many U.S. citizen family members I have. These are all the education certificates that I have. These are the job offers that I have. What happened in 1996 is it eliminated a lot of those defenses that might have been easy for someone like that to win, and it created a very narrow set of defenses that were much harder or impossible to win if you're in a situation like the ones that we saw in this documentary. So basically, if you had something called an aggravated felony, you really had no shot at staying in the country. A judge could not even hear about the good things in your life. They just really had to sign your deportation order unless he or she was sure that if you were deported to your home country, the government there would torture and kill you. So basically, what is an aggravated felony? Well, actually, or until very recently, it could be a misdemeanor in certain states. It could be a theft offense with a one-year sentence, okay? I mean, if someone was not particularly good about meeting their probation requirements, they could have had a very short sentence, like a 30-day sentence on a theft offense, and then probation violations, just tack it up to a year. You see things like that, and you're like, well, it doesn't make sense that someone who stole a car radio should be subject to deportation without a judge hearing about all the other things in their life. Maybe one mistake could prevent a judge from hearing everything that you believe should keep you here because this is your home and a lot of people care about you. So aggravated felonies. 1996 laws expanded the list of what those things were. At the top of the list, you see things like murder, rape, sexual abuse of a minor. Sounds very serious. But then the list kind of goes on and it gets a little murkier, like crime of violence with a one-year sentence, theft offense with a one-year sentence, and then it's like obstruction of justice with a one-year sentence. That's where it gets really confusing. So basically it expanded the list of crimes that you could be convicted of that would prohibit a judge from really making a fair decision in your case. And then finally it created cooperation between the federal government and local law enforcement officials that are state, local, to help them carry out immigration laws, to basically authorize them to help them look for people who may have violated immigration laws, whether it's because they don't have status or they do have status and they were admitted here lawfully. And they committed a crime or something like that. Okay, but yeah, in immigration court, it's very difficult. You don't actually have a right to a lawyer. You could have a very strong case, but if you're in detention, it's very hard to find someone to represent you. There are times that I will go to a hearing and there will be 20 people waiting for the judge to hear their case, and I will be the only attorney there to represent someone in that room. One out of 20, maybe. And that's actually kind of high. The other thing that happens in immigration court if you're detained is that you're held far away from your family. That's something that a lot of people here have mentioned. But it's also very taxing for you. If you have support outside, it's a huge strain on your family to try to find a lawyer, to try to go to your court hearings, to try to support you. And it's difficult for you too. If you have a shot at telling a judge that you have changed, it's very hard to show that if you spent years or decades in an institution. Because what you're selling them on is not necessarily how you've rehabilitated, but in their minds, just the hope that you can rehabilitate. And that's really challenging. So basically, those are a lot of the challenges that you see for someone in immigration detention. And it's compounded by other things, too. People who might not be that proficient in English, people who have mental illness. That's not often detected by an immigration judge or a Homeland Security officer. I just listened to a transcript of someone who has severe schizophrenia. He had a deportation order from 7 years ago, and when the judge asked him if he was married three different ways, each time he said, "I don't know." And English is his best language. Like, he really didn't know, and there are sometimes he doesn't understand where he is. And then there are other problems. For my clients who are women, a lot of them report feeling either violated or that they could be sexually assaulted in their facilities. Until very recently, actually, a lot of my clients didn't tell me that if I had a contact visit with them, meaning that they could sit next to me or across from me and we could pass legal papers back and forth just to get both of our signatures on it, they would actually be strip searched before and after. And this is why a lot of them, even if it made it really difficult or we had to work late into the night because the meeting took hours, because we'd have to ask a guard to come in and like pass the paperwork through glass. Even if that was the case, a lot of them really didn't want that contact visit because that strip search was so invasive. So these are just some of the challenges that you see as someone who is helping another person through the immigration process after they've come out of jail or prison.
Jacqueline, I do have a quick follow-up because we are slowly but surely making a turn for the better, particularly in the state of California. The strategy of locking people up and throwing away the key is not only inhumane, it's also costly. And a couple years ago, California passed Prop 47. Can you quickly summarize what is Prop 47 and what impact does it have for communities of color and specifically for AAPI immigrant communities?
Okay, so Prop 47 is one of the, I guess, post-conviction measures that have been passed recently. So we've been seeing a lot of criminal justice reforms, even where like immigration reforms are just totally died and are like completely hopeless. So one of those is Prop 47. It unfortunately really does not help people who have been convicted of felonies like the type that we saw in this movie. So a lot of people with gang histories will be convicted of like armed robbery, like offenses with an element of violence or use of force. Prop 47 helps people with non-violent offenses. So basically drug offenses or property crimes where the loss to the victim, say it's theft, passing a bad check, receipt of stolen property is equal to or lesser than $950. What that does is it actually, Prop 47 reduces a felony conviction to a misdemeanor if it falls within those classes. But if you had something more serious than a nonviolent, non-property offense, it does not actually help you in the immigration context, especially in the immigration context. But yeah, I mean, it, in order for, I think Prop 47 to really, or things like that to help a lot of people in our community, we have to reach beyond that. Because there are times that I do have clients. I work mostly with people who are Southeast Asian or Pacific Islander. I do see some people who qualify for Prop 47, and then you're like, okay, great. Like, now let's just wait for like future laws to be passed so that we can reduce your sentence like to under a year. I mean, it's usually not enough to help people in our community, but for people who have, say, kind of like generally nonviolent criminal histories, or just like say you have one felony and a few misdemeanors, or like one or like something very, very minor, and you lack immigration status and need something like deferred action, one of Obama's programs, it could help you. But in general, yeah, if you have anything involving use of force or violence, it actually is not necessarily that helpful to you. We get asked about it all the time. We have clients who will fill out their Prop 47 paperwork on their own and spend hours and hours and hours doing it. It definitely has helped a lot of people, but in order for us to help people in our community with these really rehabilitative measures, we do need to push a lot harder to get people to understand that, I mean, just because you have one of these more serious offenses doesn't mean that you can't be rehabilitated and that you don't deserve something similar.
So, Eddy, I want to bring you into the conversation because the system of incarceration, repression, suppression has seemingly become the norm. And this culture has also steeped its way into our school campuses, where there are often more school security officers or school police than counselors. Why are we seeing so many of our young people becoming a part of the school-to-prison-to-deportation pipeline? And can you share your thoughts on what is needed for us to intervene on this pipeline?
Well, happy new breath, everyone. So I just want to invite you, just take a deep breath. Yeah, just take another one. I think you need it. Well, I mean, that intentional breath that you took, or the couple breaths you took, you may not kind of appreciate it sometimes, because that breath that you took actually sustains your life, right? I mean, that's why I say happy new breath, is to remind myself and others not to take our breath for granted. The reason why the schools are not a place for nurturing and, you know, advancement of higher education has to deal with the United States policy in investing in profiting off of people's backs. They pour more money into building more prisons than building more schools. They pour more money into creating laws that they can criminalize people of color than really supporting social services to provide for the families and for the young people so they can have a better infrastructure in the schools and better opportunity for higher education. So when you place education second to incarceration, then obviously there's gonna be the school to prison and deportation pipeline for the immigrant population. So therefore, the way to combat it is up to every one of us to be able to really look at the system as a failure, because anytime when you have the school system who's supposed to be the pipeline to the future of this country as a pipeline to the prison industry complex, we all need to stand up and really fight for schools, not prisons. Because that would be the only way. So far, we have been divide and conquer historically on what is considered as a good immigrant, who is considered as a bad immigrant, who are the good citizens and who are not the good citizens, who are the violent criminals, who are the nonviolent criminals. So there's always something in there to separate us. So we can't find our commonality. Just like the story of many of the deportees when they get deported, just like many of the people who come out as LGBTQ, just like people who suffer mental health challenges, we don't talk about it as an Asian American Pacific Islander community enough because of the culture shame and that stigma that comes with it. But when we start talking about it, then we realize that we are not alone. This is not something that just happened to us. It happens to other people. So that's why we are never separated from the self, the family, and the community. And the way to interrupt this pipeline has to really focus on how do we create an educational system that we are all invested in it, and not just giving to an institution and let the institution take care of our children. It's how do we all play a part into having access to all the resources that could be culturally competent to immigrant populations or to people that who are learning disabilities. And that has to be the start. And we have to provide living wage to teachers, to educators, because they are the ones that who's taking care of our children, the future of this country. If they don't get the capacity building, they don't get the living wage that they have to increase their skill set, especially at the in the 21st century, then how can they be educators and nurturers for the people? And how can the school not become a prison to the school, the school to prison and deportation pipeline? How can that not be when we don't even invest in that, right? So I would say that we have to invest in education first, investing in restorative justice, investing in transformative justice practices. Whenever we have to deal with school disciplines on campuses, we need to get rid of any type of oppressive strategies in our school system and invest into mental health specialists, therapists, counselors, mentors. Those are the things that we need. We need to invest in schools and not prison.
So Eddy, you just mentioned a piece around cultural competency, and I actually wanted to see if you could also share some highlights from your work in the Roots program in San Quentin and why cultural competency is so important.
So the Asian Prison Support Committee has started a program in the San Quentin State Prison, which is in Northern California, a place that Meg and myself are very familiar with because we spent many years in there. And the Roots program is an acronym for Restoring Our Original True Self. It's named by the Asian and Pacific Islander prisoners who are doing time inside. So we were able to introduce this program in there to really assess their needs. Like, what are their needs as AAPI prisoners inside to help support their healing and eventually supporting their release from prison system and not recidivate. So we really focus on what we call the CHI, which is culture, history, and identity. So we really utilize an ethnic studies model, the curriculum model, to go in there to really highlight the history of the different AAPI countries and the community that who occupy in that space. So even just last week, we started this program, this new program in Solano, with because of the successful program that we have in Solano. We talk about, we just highlight the history from 1776 to 1965, and how the different community come into the United States and being utilized for their labor and utilized for their smarts. But yet when it comes to convenience, then they will isolate them. They'll exclude them and discriminate against them. So part of the Roots program is to be able to invest in the culture, history identity, so people will utilize that as a way of healing, to really understand that how they were traumatized, how their family was traumatized as a result of war, as a result of the displacement, as a result of the bullying that they have experienced in the schools or in this community. So that's part of the, so Roots is the only culturally competent program in the state of California out of the 33 prisons. And we started that because there was no other culturally competent programs there for the AAPI population. As I mentioned earlier, it was the cultural shame. Nobody wants to talk about it. So when you don't talk about it, people think that we have no challenges. And then the modern minority myth does not help either. Because we are not all smart in math, because I know I am not. You know, we're not all destined to be engineers and lawyers and doctors, you know. Many of us, we struggle. But unfortunately, people only hold on to that modern minority narrative and not really look at all the rest of the population and the challenge that we have to deal with. That's why the cultural history and identity piece is important, you know, in our program in San Quentin State Prison. It is equally important in our school system. That's why we need to start teaching ethnic study curriculums starting from middle school. That's what is important.
So Stephanie, what do you think young people and students like you need to be put on the school to college to career pipeline rather than the school to prison to deportation pipeline?
In my organization, we've been working on two campaigns to end the school-to-prison-to-deportation pipeline. And one of it was the Every Student Matter campaign, and this campaign fights for alternative school disciplines, practices, and restorative justice so that we can keep students in school than pushing them out. And the other campaign is Youth at the Core, and through that campaign, we were able to win a wellness center to be placed. And this is a place where the youth can go to for emotional, physical, and mental health support. And through the Wellness Center, we actually fight for the youth to stay in school and be able to focus in order to graduate. And ultimately, we need to invest in young people so that our invest in young people and our education so that the money isn't spent on the police and on prisons. And we need to change the way people perceive young people, because often people, well, teachers, people, whoever, like, we are seen as troublemakers. People think that we don't care about our school, we don't care about education, we don't care about what's going on in our community, and sometimes we are seen as criminals. And we need people that care and, like, are supportive of the things that, like, we choose to do. And we need supportive adults and institution that values and see young people as leaders and as someone who is able to make a decision.
Mech, you told me that things started turning for the worse when you were 17. Looking back on things now, how do you think the experience of being incarcerated changed you? And what message would you give to your 17-year-old self?
If I was able to go back again, I think the first thing I'd say to myself is slow down. You know, I was always on the move. Really, I had lost sight of my culture. You know, I lost sight of what a Samoan really is. You know, even at times I was embarrassed to be Samoan. You know, I remember the first time a kid asked me at school when I got here at high school, and hey, what are you? Mexican? You know, I said, no, I'm Samoan. You know, what's that? You know, and then immediately I felt embarrassed. And then I just went along with, yeah, I'm Mexican. You know, you know, and so, you know, hey, be proud of who you are. You know, there it is there. You know, whether you're Vietnamese, Chinese, Samoan, Tongan, Hawaiian, Fijian, you know, hey, be proud of who you are. You know, there was a time when I thought wearing a ulah, you know, was kind of weird, you know, because that's how I felt when I came here. You know, and so I wouldn't wear it. Now I wear it all the time. You know, I'm glad I have my family support in there. You know, because they never gave up on me. You know, my whole family continued to pray for me, fight, visit me, send letters. And even though I was hard-headed, you know, and stubborn, you know, I finally got it, you know. And now I'm out here. I mean, the first check I got out here, I took my whole family to, you know, a hometown buffet. You know, and you know, it felt good to be able to, you know, so hey, educate yourself. You know, I seen this movie on Eddy. I was a little upset I wasn't in it, you know. Because here's a perfect example of why you need to educate yourself, right? Eddy came to me in 1988 from another prison. And they got what they call as a kite. You know, it's how they send messages from prison to prison. So I get a kite saying that Eddie's on his way, you know, to embrace him and put him under your wing. So he gets there, and you saw all the muscles he had, right? You know, I contributed to that. So when he gets there, you know, we're uneducated, so we just go along with the prison politics that were given to us when I was there. So I tell him, because we're working out in the heat, he wants to drink some water. I said, no, we don't drink water. You know, it helps the muscle when you don't drink water. You know, so all that time he was with me, we never drank water. We'd be out there thirsty, you know, but you know, we pushed these politics on him to let him know that, hey, you know what, this could barely speak English. So anyways, I ended up going to the hole, you know, like I usually did. And 8 years later, I meet up with Eddy. And the first thing he says to me when he sees me is, hey, you know that stuff about not drinking water when you work out? That was bullshit. you know what I said to myself? Damn. This fool speaks English now. And what happened was he went and educated himself, you know, and started working out, you know, the right way, where you're supposed to drink water when you work out. hey, educate yourself so that you know what to do, you know, so you know how to stay out of trouble. Thank you.
I'm going to ask one last question to Ben, who is the filmmaker, and then we'll open it up. And then we'll open it up to questions and answer session with folks on the panel. So, Ben, you could have told a story entirely focused on Eddie's personal journey. Why did you decide to keep the victim's voice present throughout the film?
Yeah, so I think in the process of the filmmaking, you know, that was one of the biggest challenges, I would say, in, you know, how we would include that, in what way we would include it. And we wanted to do it in a way that didn't just kind of ignore, you know, the facts of the crime and kind of the continued legacy. And wanted to kind of push Eddy a little bit to open up about it. And, you know, I think that was a real crucial piece, you know, into the final product. There's been articles and, you know, speeches that Eddie's given. You know, he's definitely out in the community, and his story is also out in the community to an extent. But we wanted, you know, if we were going to do a documentary, we wanted to do something that I guess hadn't really been told on this depth. And so that was kind of the reason behind it. What also comes to mind, though, is you know, like was mentioned on this panel, that there are people who do commit, you know, heinous crimes, but that, you know, there is more to that person than that crime, than that single act. And so In the Roots program, for example, many of the members of the Roots program that Eddy and I work with are in prison for first-degree murder, second-degree murder, gang-related crimes, different assaults. And one of the members, his name is Sunny. I remember he was giving a talk, and one of the things he talked about was that for all of his or for many years of his early incarceration, he says he was treated as a monster, and that's how he acted, the way that he was treated, like a monster. And then it wasn't until he had an opportunity to have a conversation with somebody who told him, "You are not defined by your crime. You know, there's more to you than that act." And so that was kind of what he talked about as his kind of transformational moment. And I believe that people aren't defined by what you did when you're 15 or 16. You know, it's something that you can take responsibility for, but it doesn't have to define you.
Thank you, Ben. Thank you, awesome panelists. So now we would like to open it up. I think we have some time for a couple questions.
My question's for Eddy. If there are any CHI programs in women's prisons?
So one of the challenges that we have is that we don't uplift the women's narrative, right? Because what happened is, the reality is we live in a sexist society, right? Even when it comes to the impact of mass incarceration, women are still not talked about. So even though it's a small population in comparison to the male population, what happened in the women's population and the lack of support and services that's provided for them is just almost like the AAPI not getting all the services. It's what we call the tyranny in small numbers. So I don't know what kind of programs and what kind of really culturally competent program there is in the women's prison, right? But the next step for the Asian Prison Support Committee is to reach in to the women's prison to be really engage that population, trying to specifically focus on how do we support the AAPI that were incarcerated. So that's something that we have much work to do on.
This question is for Ben. How did you and Eddy meet, and how far do you all go in producing the documentary? In the sense, when you all met, what stage of his legal status was he going through that time when you were working on the movie?
Sure, thanks for the question. I first met Eddy, it was, I believe, 2004, and he was still incarcerated at Solano State Prison. He had just gotten out of the hole from San Quentin, which you saw in the film. And I first heard about Eddy through the Asian Prisoner Support Committee. And one of the charter members of the group was a Japanese-American activist named Yuri Kochiyama, who was a mentor of mine and who we dedicated the film to. And at the time, I was a college student at UC Davis and started just trying to find ways to support him while he was at Solano. So we worked on a book project together to publish some of the writings and artwork of AAPI prisoners. And then, and didn't have any plans for a documentary at that time. And then when he finally got released in 2007, we started working together in the Asian Prisoner Support Committee. And I had been working on some documentary films and then decided to start filming. Well, some of the footage we filmed was 2010. So basically 5-6 year project you know, that we worked on. And the earlier footage that you saw of Eddy in his parole hearings and immigration detention was filmed by a filmmaker named Ann Rogers, who generously donated her footage, which was a larger kind of a piece on lifers in a broader context. So she donated all of that footage for this project.
Thank you so much, Ben and Eddy, and for everyone for making this such a successful event. Our Asian stories are often untold, so I commend all of you for even sharing your stories. And I also am very happy that you mentioned the stigma of mental illness and mental health challenges. I wanted to ask you, Eddy, when you talk about this mental freedom, what do you say to the individuals inside?
Well, I mean, for me, I was just so fortunate in many ways that, like Meg, my family never stopped supporting me, even though they lie about me being in prison for 14 years. They never stopped supporting me. And then the community, once I was able to engage with them, they always support me and encourage me and inspire me. So my mental freedom came from really is through education. When I was able to learn how to read and write and start learning how to think and became socially and politically conscious, that's when I became mentally free. And through that freedom, I was able to find a sense of value and responsibility, not only to myself, but to the community, that I have to use my lived experience to pay forward until the day that I take my last breath. That's how I receive my mental freedom. And when I share with other folks going in right now to prisons who are doing life without the possibility of parole or triple lives, I share the same thing with them. Invest in your transformation, invest in yourself, because when you do that, you are contributing to healing. You are contributing to making a difference, not only in your lives, but in your family's life and in other people's lives. And you never know. Look at what happened to all the commutations that President Obama did in the last year. That's unprecedented. It never happened in the history of the United States that so many people would receive pardons. But that's not enough, because just like he did that pardon to all these people, it's his predecessors that would put all those people in the prison system that created that pipeline. So therefore, as citizens, as individuals that who occupy a space in help building this country, we have a responsibility to advocate for each other, to change laws and policies that can help support us and support other people that we co-live together. So mental freedom has to come from within. So I always say that we must be willing to engage on a personal revolution before we can embark on a collective revolution.
We got a last question.
My question talks to what you were just talking about, Eddy. But we've seen how many times you were rejected by the parole hearings or the parole board, and every time you seemed calm, you seemed collected. But we can only imagine the anger that might have been there or might not have been there. So my question is, how did you withstand that constant rejection for parole?
I'm gonna put Meg on this answer, because I think this is important, because he did 28 years and he gone to the parole board time and time and time again. And he doesn't necessarily have the support and the success that I had when it comes to dealing with transformation at the earlier stages. So can you attest to that, brother?
How does that feel? When you continue and how do you maintain sanity?
Hey, two words. It sucks. You know, I mean, it was rough. Like, Eddy, see, for me, when I went to board, Eddy was getting denied a year, 1 year, 1 year, 1 year. For me, they didn't want to see me in a year. You know, 5 years, hey. Let me see you in 5 years. So when they deny me 5 years, when they deny me 3 years, you know, yeah, it hurts, you know, but you find that power within you just to keep moving forward. You know, you got that family support. You got, you know, I didn't have Hey, I didn't have people out there cheering for me, you know, out there like they did it, you know. But hey, I still had, whether you got the whole neighborhood cheering for you or just a group, hey, you know, that's, you feel like everybody out there is cheering for you. So, you know, that gives you that power, that gives you that strength, that gives you the courage to keep moving on. You know, a lot of times, you know, at the beginning, I just looked at it like, hey, it is what it is. You know, I got to be here. I got to get through this. You know, and you know how Samoans are. No matter what the issue is, once we eat something, we feel better.
So I just want to kind of wrap that up real quick. Is resiliency. It's the resiliency that our community who is having to survive day to day right now under this type of conditions as a result of trauma of war or as a result of trauma of displacement and criminalization, oppression, is that resiliency that we find in the support of our family and support our community that keeps us going. So it kept me going when I was inside. You know, one of the worst feelings that I had is not only about being rejected when I was trying to apply for parole, knowing that I'm ready to be out there to be a productive member of society. It's that I have to continue to ask my friends to write support letters for me. I hated doing that because I don't want them to keep writing, asking them to help me, because I want to be there for them. So every time that I get rejected, I have to go right back to them and say, can you write a support letter for me? And my childhood friend, they told me, they say, Eddy, why do we have to write letters? Can we not write letters? We just want you to come home. I say, if you don't write the support letters, I wouldn't come home. So it's those type of frustration that the community, my friends were feeling that I mostly was hurt about, because I know how to take care of myself. How am I going to take care of my friends and family, make sure that they are not feeling that disappointment? And that's essentially what I see in the leadership in all these young people, not only in KGA, but in many of the young people who participate into advocating for themselves, for their family, and for their community, because they are the one that who show in resiliency. They are the one that who's teaching us about the future resides in the collective power that we have. So again, we took up a lot of space as males in this community. Even on this panel, we took up a lot of space. But the women are the one that who holds up half the sky. And when are we starting appreciating that?
So thank you so much to our panelists. And before we all jump up and take our selfies with all these incredible people, I would like to invite up Alex Siv to do our closing performance.
We are seeking refuge, exchanging thought for food, drug use to avoid feeling blue, and need for a change of perspective into a brighter hue. The world is rude, no place for a sensitive human being under constant changing moods. How can we elude the force that is brute? Pressure to change who we are when we are crude. Boo-hoo, they say man up and be a real dude. But the system ain't fair, they're here to fail us. Throw us under the bus and manipulate our trust while all our dreams are crushed. Take away the ones that are close to us. Neglect our freedoms while our spirits vanish. Ain't no place like this. The United States of America leaves me with unanswered questions. All our Asian and Pacific Islander brothers struggle with direction. One mistake and there's no giving compassion. Back then, they would try a juvenile as an adult, but then again, that so happens. Zero chances, transition from prison to prison, and finally deportation. This is torture that is endless. Life ended when we were sentenced, sent to a country we called the motherland, but this was different. All alone, filled with isolation. Nowhere to go, no destination. This takes a toll, so I hope you listen. Deportation does not solve anything. You are severing families and parentless children. You are a treacherous pilgrim, wiping us out like all the Indians. Why focus on punishment rather than rehabilitation? Does our existence matter to you, you gosh damn pilgrim? You are stealing freedom. You are stealing our right to live, our right to be free. Permanent shackles just because of one mistake, this is not easy. See, this is family, and if you take that away, then how can one truly see? So congratulations, America. You have the stories of man's life and what he was supposed to be. You silence our voices with nothing else to plead. With no sense of hope to ever being free. You are stepping on us until we bleed. Give us the boot with no directions to read. Exiled from a country we once sought for refuge, now seen as the enemy. Despite all the hard work and the struggle for earning money, we are now left with you as born children asking for their daddy. Single mother struggling with to pay the bills. Isn't that saddening? It's exactly maddening. Our government is tearing us from the inside out while there is no way out. Where is the support and where is the justice? This fight for injustice has to go on until we reach a consensus that we are all human beings, that we can all learn from our lessons, that we are not permanent criminals. We are people that can listen, people that can change for the better and be someone, be a voice that deserves to be listened to because we brew difference and individuality, the whole pot of stew. Hands up, don't shoot. This is a life we don't want yet to conclude. Thank you, everyone.